You wake up. The air feels heavy, but familiar. You look around. Everything is in place. Your hands, your coffee, the screen in front of you, but something's off. A faint feeling, like a sound you can't hear, but somehow know is there. Like a glitch in gravity, like waking up inside the dream when you were sure you were awake. Scientists call this déjà vu. Philosophers call it a fracture in the illusion. And maybe it is. Maybe what you see isn't real. Not because it's fake, but because it's already over. There's a theory that your life right now is the final echo of a consciousness unraveling. That the moment of death isn't when your heart stops, but when your mind stops resisting. And until that happens, it creates a world, a reality. One last story to die inside. They say death is a moment, a flat line on a screen, a final breath, silence. But the body doesn't work like a movie. When the heart stops, the blood doesn't just vanish, oxygen lingers, cells keep trying, and the brain resists. In some cases, measurable brain activity continues for several minutes. Not just noise, patterns, surges, bursts of energy, right after the moment we call death. Some scientists call it the final storm, a last attempt to restore order. Others believe it's a flood of neurotransmitters, a psychedelic cascade. But there's another idea. Maybe it's not collapse. Maybe it's creation. The brain, stripped of time and space, begins to construct its final scene. Not randomly, not passively, but with everything it has left. A full experience, a world, maybe even a life. The dying brain could be telling itself one last story, and you, right now, could be living inside it. We like to think the world is outside us, that it continues, with or without us, that we are passengers, watching the universe from the windows of our minds. But some theories suggest the opposite. What if the world isn't something you observe, but something you generate? Biocentrism, a controversial idea, simple in theory, devastating in implication. It proposes that time and space don't exist independently. They are tools, constructs, shaped by consciousness. In this view, you're not a small observer of reality. You are the projector. Everything you see, the people, the trees, the sky, the stars, exists because you are looking. Stop observing, and the movie ends. Stop existing, and reality folds. This is more than philosophy. It's supported by the strange behavior of quantum particles. They don't exist in fixed states until observed. Reality, at the smallest level, waits to be noticed. So what happens when the observer dies? Does the world vanish with them? Or worse? Does the mind, unable to accept that vanishing, create a new world to escape into? One last world. One that feels real, because it has to. We live inside a calendar. Birthdays, deadlines, aging skin. We measure time with clocks and call it real, but physics doesn't agree. Einstein once wrote that the distinction between past, present, and future is only a stubborn illusion. Time bends, stretches, dilates. Two people can experience it differently depending on speed and gravity. In space, clocks tick slower. In motion, aging pauses. There is no universal now. Some physicists suggest the past and future already exist. frozen in space-time like pages in a book. You don't move through time. You move through perception. So when your brain begins to die, what happens to your sense of time? If a single second can hold a lifetime of memory in a dream, what could 5 seconds of neural chaos create? A world, a life, a loop? The mind doesn't need real time. It only needs the illusion of time. And illusions are what the brain is best at. You might be living a full narrative right now, inside a moment that's already ended. Some people die and come back. No heartbeat, no breath, no measurable brain waves. Yet when they return, they describe things, see things, feel things. They talk about tunnels of light, about floating above the body, about peace, fear, timelessness. These are called near-death experiences, NDEs. They've been reported by millions. And the stories, while different, share patterns. A sense of detachment, a calm presence, a review of one's life, a message, sometimes spoken, sometimes felt, telling them, it's not time yet. Science tries to explain them, lack of oxygen, electrical misfires, psychedelic chemicals. But that doesn't explain everything. Because some of these people come back with knowledge they couldn't have had. They describe the tools used on them, the conversations in the room, even the color of a nurse's shoelaces, all while they were clinically dead. So is this the soul escaping? Or is it the mind creating? Or is it something else entirely? Maybe these are leaks, not of heaven, not of hell, but of the mechanism itself. Maybe in death, the mind cracks, and through that crack, something timeless leaks in. Or maybe this is the crack, and you're already inside it. Maybe you've never left the dream. Maybe you are the dream. Solipsism suggests you're the only conscious being that exists, that everyone and everything around you is part of your mind's construction. No friends, no strangers, no world, just reflections. Your dreams already do this. They simulate people, voices, entire landscapes, all without help, all within seconds. Now imagine your dying brain doing the same. Some take it further. Simulation theory suggests you live in a hyper-real system, a digital construct so perfect you don't realize it's fake. But maybe the simulation isn't artificial. Maybe it's biological. A simulation built by the brain. There's no machine, no programmer, just neurons firing their last signals, creating a final version of reality that never truly ends. And in Buddhist death loop concepts, there's an even stranger idea that when consciousness fails to detach, it recycles itself, trapped in its own karmic illusion. It replays the same memories, the same people, the same tragedies and hopes. A loop with no door. Unless you choose to stop believing it's real. So what now? Let's assume the theory is true. You've already died. And this is the last echo of your mind, fading slowly. Then none of this matters. And yet, it does. Because you feel it. Joy, pain, longing, wonder, real or not, it moves you. So maybe the question isn't, are we dead? Maybe it's, are we paying attention? Because whether this is life or death, dream or illusion, you're still here. And as long as you're here, you still have a choice. To exist passively, or to live deliberately, to question, to feel, to wake up, even inside a dream. If you're still here, maybe you're not afraid of death. Maybe you're afraid of waking up. Subscribe if you're ready to ask the next impossible question.